guys, this is Jonathan Jensen here at TheEssentialVermeer.com. Here's my take on Vermeer's Girl with a Flute. In early November 2022, the Washington National Gallery of Art proclaimed the Girl with a Flute is not by Vermeer's hand, but by some unknown person who worked in the painter's studio, who they called the other artist. The NGA's rejection is based on a combination of what they believe are compositional, stylistic, material, and technical incongruities. To dig deeper, check out the link below to the NGA report. There's lots to be considered here, so let me unpack things bit by bit. First, the NGA's objections, and then who they think the other artist might be. But first, I have to confess, I'm biased. Despite its imperfections, I've always had a soft spot for this minuscule object. I was incredibly lucky to have seen it without its frame, laying on a table in the NGA Conservation Department many years ago. I was so struck by its fragile and dreamy beauty that, at the moment, it didn't even matter who might have painted it. Sentiments aside, I think there are very good reasons to maintain that it was made by, or at least begun by, Vermeer. To understand what follows, it's critical to keep in mind that the Girl with the Flute belonged to a defunct category of Dutch painting called the Tronie. Although Tronies represent a bust-length figure on a neutral background, they weren't formal portraits, but a sort of artistic free-for-all, where painters could try out novel subjects, experiment with new techniques, and hopefully pocket a bit of extra income from a client who couldn't afford one of the artist's more elaborate pieces. Favorite subjects were drunkards, country bumpkins, fools, swaggering soldiers, mischievous children, and young women sporting ostentatious costumes or particularly exotic headgear, like the NGA's Girl with a Flute or the Girl with a Red Hat. Now, let's take a look at what the NGA believes are the work's compositional weaknesses. Quote, the figure is frontal, static, her arms and hands are awkwardly articulated, and we have only the vaguest sense of the body beneath her fur-trimmed robe. Rather than venturing an oblique glance from over her shoulder, the woman looks at us straight on. There's little attempt at intrigue or beguilement, unquote. Aside from the fact that beguilement is a pretty subjective value, and intrigue is even harder to pin down in a painting, should we really expect such a creative painter as Vermeer to adopt the same pose for every one of his tronies? True, some of Vermeer's females are beguiling, as the NGA claims, but Vermeer explored a rather wide range of female expressions, from demure to coy, timid, thoughtful, frightened, and still others quite direct. And at least to me, the girl was meant to be engaging, even subtly confrontational. And no, the pose of the sitter is not really static at all, at least no more static than any other pose by Vermeer. The girl is in fact positioned off-center. She leans so far to the right, she's forced to balance herself on the edge of the table that we barely see in the foreground. Well, yes, we sometimes do sense the body beneath the clothes of Vermeer's sitters, but then again, sometimes we really don't. And the jacket of the girl is so loose-fitting that, frankly, I don't know exactly what the NGA expects to see here. It's rendered more or less like the jacket in Vermeer's love letter. You can understand the color and the folds of the fabric, but there's definitely no hint of the woman's body. Now consider Vermeer's guitar player just for a moment, painted some years after The Girl with Flute. Despite the different level of complexity and finish, the two works really share quite a bit. Notice how the arm is locked off exactly as it is in The Girl with a Flute. This is so unusual that some critics believed it could be tied with Vermeer's involvement with an optical device called the camera obscura, which, like the modern-day photographic camera, frames the world casually, without thinking it will look particularly nice in a painting. Notice how the figure is displayed frontally, off-center, and leaning to the right, again exactly as in The Girl with the Flute. And if you look carefully enough, you'll spot the silhouette of the lion head finial peeking out over the left-hand shoulder, just as it does in The Girl with the Flute. The peculiar abstract treatment of the fur trim is also very similar in both works. Okay, so what's up? What's really my point here? Well, the compositional similarities between the two pictures are, I believe, so strong that The Girl with the Flute may have been the inspiration for the more ambitious guitar player. Nothing strange here at all. Vermeer often expanded on previous compositions in highly creative manners. Look how the crouched figure of the lace maker is recycled to the more complex lady writing a letter with her maid. So if the girl with the flute is not by Vermeer, as the NGA claims, we have no choice but to believe that the other artist provided the great Vermeer with a highly innovative composition. And so he starts looking more like a prophet than a pupil. The NGA also claims that the lionhead finial of the Spanish chair is weakly defined when compared to the one of the girl with the red hat. In their words, it's, quote, awkwardly rendered, the brushwork is blocky, and does little to create a sense of form or volume, and the few curves and dashes of the midtones are little more than patches of color on a poorly defined form, unquote. Okay, then take a look at how Vermeer painted the same finial in his Women Holding a Water Pitcher. It's a world apart. So the question, again, is obvious. Did Vermeer have to paint every lionhead finial the same way in every picture? Now, one more observation before we leave the finials alone. Note the finials of the girl with the red hat. The right-hand one faces the viewer directly. The left-hand one is rotated slightly to the right. If both of the finials belong to the same chair, then this really isn't possible. Such a gross deviation from reality is so remarkable in Vermeer's work that some credible Vermeer specialists have excluded the painting from the artist's oeuvre. And yet, the NGA brushes the problem aside, suggesting that the finials may have belonged to two different chairs, which, to me at least, seems a bit like wishful thinking. In any case, the NGA seems rather tolerant to the stylistic inconsistencies of the girl with the red hat, but much less so to those of the girl with the flute. Now, here's my point. I think we should expect variations, even among very similar works by a painter as creative as Vermeer. Painters are not machines who turn out works for the benefit of art historical consistency. Just like handwriting, a painter will, to some degree, change how he paints from day to day. And whether you're a great genius or not, some days are better and some days are worse. Now, let's take a look at the fur trim on the right-hand sleeve. There's absolutely nothing so daring in previous works. See how Vermeer handled the exact same motif in earlier paintings, the lady riding and the mistress in maid. Okay, the passage in The Girl with the Flute is not in great condition, but it's conserved well enough to see that the painter has strayed quite far from convention. Its abstract, cloud-like presence spills out toward the viewer, anticipating the rather bizarre treatment we see in the sleeves of the lady seated at the Virginal, painted years later. Note, too, how the same motif was rendered by two of Vermeer's most accomplished competitors, Gabriel Metsu and Frans van Mieris. The difference must have been a bit shocking to a 17th century Dutchman, and it's perhaps no wonder that Vermeer's imitators never really ventured so far. Vermeer's paintings are well known for their so-called pointy lay, which critics have linked to an optical device called the camera obscura. The most famous pointy lay are those of the Beau of Delft and, of course, the Milkmaid. Like the modern photographic camera, in strong lighting conditions, the camera obscura produces an optical phenomena referred to as disks of confusion. Naturally occurring pinpoint highlights spread out like sequins of light that seem to hover slightly above the surface of the object they belong to. Evidently, Vermeer observed pointillé in his camera obscura and imitated them with dots and dashes of light paint, sometimes exaggerating quite a bit. In The Girl with the Red Hat and The Girl with the Flute, notice how similar they are as they dance ever so slightly above the surface of the satin jacket. Now, here's just one more optical detail on The Girl with the Flute I believe suggests Vermeer's handiwork. Using a fine-tip brush, the artist flicked a bit of fluid paint over the edge of the fur trim here and there, perhaps to suggest its softness or even the effect of the camera obscura. In The Girl with the Red Hat, very similar marks can be seen along the edge of the hat. Yes, making a fuss about marks no larger than a few millimeters may seem niggling, but art specialists have learned that even stylistic quirks like these can be key to understanding who's handling the brush. By the way, the matted, packed quality of the left-hand sleeve makes me think that it was retouched by a later hand. The painter tried to imitate Vermeer's dancing brush marks, but they seem stuck on the surface of the fur, like confetti. And in the case you think imitating Vermeer's unique brushwork requires only a few years of training, and the NGA seems to think so, consider Gabriel Metsu's Women Reading a Letter. Even though Metsu was one of the most skilled painters of the 17th century, his renditions of Vermeer's trademark pointillé, sprinkled randomly on the skirt and the foreground shoe, come off as bright dots of paint instead of shimmering globules of light we see in The Girl with the Flute and The Girl with the Red Hat. The girl's conical hat is only offhandedly dealt with by the NGA. This, I think, is unfortunate because it is one of the most interesting passages of the work. Yes, as a hat, it's a bit less eye-catching than the one of the girl with the red hat, but it's fundamental to the composition. Its strong triangular shape and parallel stripes contrast with the softer, organic shapes that surround it, instilling visual tension and activating the otherwise uncomplicated composition. Note how the stripes draw the gaze like a magnet into the picture. I think if they were angled sideways, our gaze would be deflected away from the figure. And the sharp contrast between the brim of the hat and the girl's shadowed face lurking below creates such a tangible sensation of space that since the very first time I laid my eyes on the painting, it's given me an impression, or perhaps the desire, to put my finger underneath it and flip it right off her head. I mean, that's just how real it looks. Now, let's analyze the figure's arm, which the NGA finds awkwardly articulated. Philip Leslie Hale, an early 20th century American art writer and painter, well-versed in academic tradition, noted that Vermeer wasn't so great at anatomy. He wrote, quote, "Vermeer did not draw structurally well at all. While many Dutch painters knew their anatomy and constructed their figures understandingly, it's questionable if Vermeer really understood the construction of an arm, a wrist, the hand, a knee, or the foot." Over the years, various critics have echoed the same point. Of course, you can never really know whether it's a fault or a stylistic liberty, but the arm of the girl with the flute is rendered no worse than the arms in other paintings by Vermeer, like the lady seated at the virginal, the lady writing a letter with her maid, or the girl with a wine glass. And then what to say about the hand of the seated artist in Vermeer's masterpiece, The Art of Painting? In addition, remember all four of the pictures I just mentioned are among his most highly finished pieces, where you'd expect great attention to detail. So yes, the arm of the girl with the flute may not be one of the most inspiring passages of this little picture, but to claim it says anything meaningful about the work's authenticity, I believe is quite a stretch. The NGA also called attention to the hand that holds the flute, which former critics thought was weakly executed and particularly awkward, unworthy of the master. In effect, you might say that the finger that rests on the flute isn't painted with any particular attention, but have a look at the ear of the girl with the red hat. It's done in the same style, just a quick nonchalant brushstroke of fluid paint that, however, does what it's supposed to do, look like a finger or an ear lost in shadow without drawing any attention away from the more important parts of the picture. The NGA has detected various inconsistencies in the paint structure of the girl with the flute, which they believe show the work isn't by Vermeer. Here's what they found. The ground was approximately applied with thick paint. Some parts of the picture's surface are almost granular. The pigments aren't ground according to Vermeer's standard practice, by which the lower layers of paint were ground more coarsely, while the paints of the upper layers were ground much more finely. The underpainting of the left-hand side of the girl's jacket is brushed in quickly, with no attempt to model form. Certain kinds of cracks suggest that fresh paint was applied over the lower layer of paint before it was sufficiently dried. And the green earth pigment used in the shadows of the flesh tones in the NGA's two tronies was different. Now, according to the NGA, all these anomalies are unequivocal signs that the other artist was, quote, "someone who understood Vermeer's process and materials, but was unable to completely master them," unquote. Now, keep in mind, per se, none of these anomalies can conclusively prove or disprove the painting is by Vermeer. Remember, a poorly conserved 350-year-old painting can be a nightmare to decipher. Making sense of hazy images created by state-of-the-art technology and microscopic bits and pieces of paint is like piecing together fragments of an ancient vase, which makes no sense whatsoever unless you piece them together properly. And to piece them together properly, you have to consider many things. Let's take, for example, the girl with the red hat. It was painted over a portrait by an unknown author, and to boot, there's no intermediate ground between Vermeer's painting and the portrait below. He just flipped it upside down and started painting on it directly. It's hard to imagine anything more atypical for Vermeer, if, of course, you hold the painting to Vermeer's highest standards. So why don't we just go ahead and disqualify the girl with the red hat too? In any case, at least some of the flaws of the girl with the flute may have to do with its poor state of conservation rather than how it was painted. A number of Vermeer paintings are at least as distraught as the girl with the flute, but we still hold them as genuine. The girl interrupted in her music, well, it's almost a disaster. The birdcage, the thick candy apple glaze applied to the girl's jacket, the confused modeling of the gentleman's cloak, the splotchy surface of the background wall and the ghost-like Cupid in the background tell us that this work was seriously damaged by both nature and man. The few parts that remain intact, such as the window, the table, and the foreground chair, display a subtlety of touch and sensitivity to light that is in line with what we see in Vermeer's best works. So, we're pretty sure it's a Vermeer. Okay, I get it, but exactly who was the NGA's mysterious other artist? Well, even the NGA admits there are, quote, remarkable formal, technical, and material similarities between their two tronies. So, we're not talking about a clumsy Van Meegeren forgery debunked a few years after its appearance on the art market. The girl with the flute has definitely shown quite a bit of staying power, and has proved to be convincing enough to have fooled generations of dedicated art specialists. In addition, we can't really rule out that it was one of Vermeer's first small-scale tronies, if not the very first work on panel, which I think would explain the anomalies detected by the NGA without traumatizing the art community. Now, let's see how the NGA deals with this problem. Who exactly was this other painter? They suggest a few alternatives, but don't really bet on anyone in particular. An apprentice, or a, quote, well-to-do amateur who desired only to learn the rudiments of drawing or painting in order to become more knowledgeable about the fine arts, unquote. The NGA also suggests Vermeer might have, quote, enlisted the services of a journeyman painter, a trained but not yet independent artist on an ad hoc project-by-project basis, unquote, or even a member of Vermeer's family. There is, however, no archival evidence of any such relationships. And furthermore, we should consider a few dates. Modern scholars date the picture between 1665 and 1670, so if we subtract the year Vermeer initiated his artistic training, about 1648, well, then we discovered he toiled about 20 years to reach the level of artistic maturity and technical competence we see in both of the NGA tronies. And now a few questions. Could a well-to-do gentleman amateur have assimilated the style and atmosphere of this master in a few brief years of studio experience, especially considering the NGA suggests he only wanted to learn the rudiments of drawing and painting? Or how likely is it Vermeer would have enlisted a journeyman on an ad hoc project-by-project basis to produce a single 20x18cm picture? This leaves the family member or an apprentice. Vermeer's daughter Maria, his eldest child, was born in 1654. At the time the painting was made, she would have been about 14 years old. Even if she inherited 110% of her father's talent, is it possible that she learned in a few years what took her father almost 20? The last and probably most reasonable candidate for the other artist is an apprentice. As a professional painter who's attempted to emulate Vermeer's style for decades, I can tell you that unless you have more than a few years of studio experience under your belt, the finesse, the spontaneity, and the original composition of the girl with the flute are easy to underestimate. If my argument doesn't seem to square, then please take a look at Vermeer's early Diana and her companions and see what he was able to do after years of hard training. Take my word, the composition is a mess. And the technical shortcomings, they're just too many to count. Look at the figure in the background. Is it a man? Or is it a woman? The orange drapery? It's horrible. And what to say about the frightening piece of shrubbery, or the lavender rock, which one Vermeer expert called a sack of potatoes? And yet, the painting is by one of the greatest painting technicians of European art. One last consideration. Whoever the NGA's other artist might have been, why in the world did he create only one single work? So, what's my conclusion? Maybe the other artist was just Vermeer, but a Vermeer who was slightly different from the perfectly consistent, godlike artist we know and love, holding every work to the artist's highest standards, especially a trony, which is by definition impromptu, is to forget, after all, he was a human being. The fact that the quality of Vermeer's output is so unusually high doesn't necessarily mean everything he did was a masterpiece. If not, we'd have to discard a number of works which are decidedly subpar and riddled with hard-to-explain anomalies. Now, here's how I see it. The Girl with the Flute was begun by Vermeer, abandoned and then retouched by some later hand. Vermeer would have quickly prepared the panel with the materials that he had on hand, invented the composition, blocked in the principal passages, and then refined the parts he was more sympathetic to. Perhaps unsatisfied with the result, he set the picture aside for a later day, or just outright abandoned it. And keep in mind the economics too. The small-scale, uncomplicated Girl with a Flute would have brought the artist much less economic satisfaction than a larger genre piece. In the 1696 auction of 21 paintings by Vermeer held in Amsterdam, three cronies were sold respectively for 34, 17, and 17 guilders. Now, you'd expect small-scale tronies like The Girl with the Red Hat or The Girl with the Flute would go for 17 guilders rather than 34. In the same auction, the larger and much more labor-intensive Women Holding a Balance went for 155 guilders. Now, that's almost 10 times as much. So, when the NGA compares the shortcomings of The Girl with the Flute to the near technical perfections of the Women Holding a Balance, that's definitely comparing apples to pears. Moral of the story. In spite of its relative modesty, The Girl with the Flute and its companion, Girl with the Red Hat, may have cleared the path for the bolder compositions and the abstract style of his latest works, such as The Guitar Player, The Lady Standing at the Virginal, The Love Letter, and of course, The Lacemaker. Now, if I'm right here, then that's quite an achievement for such a tiny work. So, before banishing this admittedly imperfect work from Vermeer's oeuvre, I'd recommend taking a much longer and a much closer look at the surface of the canvas, rather than what's hidden away from human eyes. Let me know what you think in your comments below. Jonathan Jansen, here at theessentialvermeer.com.